how the mind creates all of that. How does the mind create samsara and nirvana? So the mind itself is like space. It is clear and empty. It is said that when you know the basis, then no other view is needed. That is the view. So it is the natural state of your mind, or the primordial natural state of the mind. And that is your completely pure, this pristinely pure state of mind in its natural state. So in the teachings of Mahamudra and Dzogchen, that is what we are introduced to, the state of mind in its natural state, that is free of all concepts, all thoughts, the primordial mind. And that is the basis for samsara and nirvana. We call it the nature of the mind. The way samsara is created is like that, and the way the Buddha is created is through the altruistic mind. So that we need to understand very clearly. And then we understand that it's actually just a condition. One condition leads to samsara, and the other one leads to Buddhahood. But actually, in the mind, all of it does not exist. The mind is just naturally clear and pure, and without any conceptual elaboration at all. So that is what needs to be understood here. And so for that, we need to understand those subtle workings of karma. When one dies, the consciousness leaves the body, then the consciousness is taken by the karmic winds. And that means that whichever of the afflictions, the afflictive emotions, is predominant, the strongest, these are the karmic winds that will take the consciousness. So for a practitioner, it is different. The practitioner does not become controlled by the afflictive emotions. Even if they arise, they are able to let go of them again. So they will not pursue the afflictive emotion. And that is what we call freedom, or like freedom of awareness. Awareness is free and is held with stability. So if you know that, you know the view. So it is, the view is sustained by sustaining a stability of awareness. So now we speak about karma, but we just really talk about it. We think, I know karma and so on, but still, even though we say that, there still is this self, selfishness. We consider ourselves as most important because we don't really understand that karma is actually happening within the mind. And then when somebody comes to hurt you, immediately you are offended and you say, oh, he's hurting me. You're really hurting yourself by not recognizing that. For example, like this example of the poisonous snake, who is a manifestation of hatred. So if you just understand one single example, actually, that's enough for you to understand the fault of hatred, for example. And so within the basis is that is Buddha nature, none of that actually exists. So if you do not follow it, whatever arises, that mind is the mind of the Buddha, that single basis that is explained in the Samantabhadra prayer. So karma is momentary. It arises due to momentary conditions. So the Buddha had said, beings are actually Buddhas. All sentient beings are actually Buddhas. They are only obscured by momentary stains. But what actually is there when those stains have disappeared is that primordial, fundamental nature of mind. And now when you try to find that concept of an I, of a self, we have mentioned you cannot find it. So it is only a temporary condition that leads to an affliction. Due to that affliction, there is this concept of me. And we always come back to it because we get angry, for example. For example, if someone insults me, then immediately I'm stirred up and this I has come back. He is insulting me, for example. What's going to happen to me? I have this problem or that problem. And everything is just about me all the time, or someone is hurting me. And so in this way, as we are holding on, fixating on our afflictive emotions, we are actually accumulating karma.